one of the important issues for service delivery. I'm really smitten by one thing, that when we talk of citizen service delivery, what is the service which we deliver to a citizen without any manual intervention? Is there any service which a citizen can avail? Is there any single government service which a citizen can avail in the same manner as a citizen can book his air ticket on yatra.com or makemytrip.com, or he can do it on his railway ticket? I really find myself at a loss to see, and wherever in the complete life cycle of any citizen service we have even a minimal of manual intervention, the whole cycle gets broken. On our end, we don't realize the pain of these complexities of delivery of services so long as we are in service, because the institution of PA has the biggest spoiling effect on officers who are supposed to lead it. We would tell a PA, get my driving license renewed. It is this guy who goes and gets it done. Get my PAN. Get me the form printed. He follows it up. But the moment you as a citizen queue up and you are asked to fill up various forms, and then you wait, and then you wait for approvals of different authorities, it is only at that stage that the realization comes, can't we simplify these processes? Can't we do something to it? Why is it required? And probably that is why the foundation for e-governance rests in governance first. We have to have first a streamlined system of governance. Only then e-governance takes on. A number of efforts have been made at Government of India level, state level. Some work has been done in piecemeal within the given limitations and constraints. But it has really not led to the satisfaction of the one who is sensitive about providing the services using ICT in a hassle-free manner, nor to the satisfaction of the recipient. When the Government of India talked about e-district project, I talked to the Secretary DP. Frankly, until date, I have not been able to understand what is the rationale of e-district. What is this e-district? So they told me, it's a real story I'm sharing with you. I was told, we found that the back-end processes of different departments should be taken up for bringing into the system at the district level. So I asked them, how can that be? Because a district office does not exist in isolation of department as one unit. And the processes start at the department level and they filter down to the field level. So in isolation, a district level back-end operation cannot be developed. If it is developed, then do you think Haryana would have 21 back-end districts? It has to be one integrated application. So they said, no, database also. I said, then where do you get that database at the district level? If you have to collect the resident database or the database, then it emanates either at the village level or the municipal ward level. Because as I look at it, the flow of ICT is that you have an application which flows downwards, you have a data which flows from lower side, and it is a complete one single aggregated kind of a structure. It was in this context that within our team I started posing this question: why don't we think in terms of creating a e-shop in a village? How is it that we don't know? There is no system. As a matter of fact, I wonder if Vikas is here. He was there. Okay, Mr. Vikas Gupta is now looking after this. We're looking after earlier. For some time, Nitin was looking after development and panchayat. He still does. So I was asking him, I said, do you have an asset register of what is there in a gram panchayat jurisdiction? The assets in a gram panchayat jurisdiction are owned by 9 departments. There is no single place where one would know, hey, this village has these 21 or 23 or 30 infrastructure assets. A water supply scheme, an electricity substation, a primary school, a secondary school, a stockman center, a PHC or a CHC. All those assets which are owned by 9 departments are not available at one single place. In a village, if it is bigger than a village or in a cluster, if there is a guy who is a certified seed seller for agriculture, if there is a certified pesticide seller in that place, somebody wants to know, I need to go to and find out who sells pesticides here, who is authorized to sell pesticides. There is no way, we don't have information. So what was felt is that a citizen is helped in multiple ways. One is, a citizen needs to know that he has a particular problem. Where should he go to get that problem solved? And what are the processes to get that problem solved? Secondly, once he knows this is where he should go, then how should there be some kind of a process defined and a sanctity of delivery of that service in an efficient and transparent manner? When we looked at this puzzle, we started talking about development of an application which gives you an integrated village information services delivery system. And that's how the work on IDIS was started. Eventually, the foundation of IDIS got built on a resident database, which is validated at the time you are placing reliance on, and incrementally built up. And that is why we looked at it, that if you capture the resident database for a village at one point in time, I think after a month it's going to be redundant. Unless you integrate the birth register of the state and the death register of the state, and also a marriage register. Because within Haryana, a number of migrations take place on account of marriage. We did not think of a solution where people from other states are migrating on account of nature of work or engagement or employment. But we said, let us first address these concerns in order to update this database. Then another major challenge came. How do I say this database is really reliable and good, based on which we can deliver services? So we said, okay, we'll keep it an evolving model. We'll keep it a changing model. As and when a citizen approaches this front end, he is shown his data. What do we have about it? He is first told, hey guy, look, this is the information we have on you. Do you think it needs to be corrected? Do you think it needs to be enriched? Do you think it needs to be, please share that information with us. And with each event, we keep on taking that as a part of build-up of that database. The current status of governance, I've shared with you how all of us are faced with the problem of really delivering a service to the satisfaction of both sides. The demonstration of the software will be taken along by Shastri as I go along with this presentation. I think one of the issues that came is with regard to the identity of a person. How do you identify a person? You first have, say for example, each state has a typical culture, and that culture brings in a few names which are very commonly known. And a culture like Haryana, Mahender, Rajveer, Rajender, Rajpal, these are the names which in a village, at one time, there may be 10 Rajveers, there may be 10 Mahenders, there may be 10 Rajenders. In four cases, Rajender's father also may be another Rajpal or another Virender or another man. And that each name is also being spelled differently in different databases. Social Justice has a database. Pranab talked to you just before this. He has about 22 lakh clients in his storage whom he is serving every month. Education Department has its database where more than 16 lakh children are in the schools to whom scholarships or some kind of benefits are being administered. The below poverty line people who are entitled to distribution of subsidized food grains under the public distribution system is another database. But interestingly, in the state, none of these databases talk to each other. And if you try and make an effort that they talk to each other, I think the first impression is you will go mad, so don't touch it. Because one person, his name may be spent in five different ways. So, this was the issue which was addressed, that if Mahender here is spelled as M-O-H-I-N-D-E-R in one database, M-A-H-E-N-D-R-E in another database, let us try to fix his identity not linked with these bunch of characters, but through a number of other factors where we say we will correct the spelling. So his name or his identity is not really marked by only these bunch of characters which give him some different identity. Except same problem would be there with the address. Then rural addresses in particular, as a matter of fact, urban address, if you look at it, one would still say this house number, this ward number or something of the kind. In rural areas, those of you who are familiar with Haryana, my knowledge beyond Haryana is very limited. Within the Lal Dora, as they call it, the Safed Jameen, there is no number assigned to any plot. A person is known as Satpal, son of so-and-so, village this, V&TOS. So it is the postman who knows and who takes it. It is really not identified. Uska koi ghar ka number nahi hai, koi ab chula tax khatam ho gaya hai. So this really poses a serious problem in terms of address also. We'd like to come on that demo part now. Please. I think I'll request Shastri to come on how true, real identity is sought to be established through